Good afternoon, everyone. My name is David Duckworth, City Manager, and thanks for being here this afternoon. So earlier today, administration presented council with the 2020 adjustments to the One Calgary service plans and budgets. The proposed adjustments respond to changes in the local economy, as well as shifts in the community needs and priorities. As directed by council on July 16th, administration prepared two reduction scenarios to tax-supported services, equivalent to tax increases of 1.5% and 0% for 2020. These scenarios align with the guiding principles set by council that include a least harm approach to services for citizens and treating employees with dignity and respect. The city delivers value to Calgarians every day for the taxes they pay. We are committed to being a service-based organization and are always looking for ways to enhance the efficiency and effectiveness of the services that we provide. We'd like to thank our general managers and many other city staff who've worked hard to deliver these scenarios for council's consideration. With that, we will be happy to take your questions, but please understand that because council still needs to deliberate and make decisions at the end of November, and out of respect to our employees, there may be some questions we may not be able to answer today. So with that, we'll entertain any questions that you have.
How do you explain in real simple terms that you could have, like, for instance, a 0% scenario, and at the same time, the operating budget still be higher than last year? Just to explain that and kind of pretend we're a grade 7 class and you won't be far wrong, at least in my case.
What I would answer for that is tax support is one of the revenue streams in our city's budget. There are other streams as well, user fees, like the transit fares that get paid every day. We also have things like franchise fees and a number of other revenue sources. So when you take a look at the absolute tax supported number, that may grow because of these other revenue sources. So there may be assessment growth in that number. There could be user fee growth. So year over year, the total amount of expenditures may change, but today what we were talking about is that net number. When you take all of the revenues less all of the service expenditures, what that overall net level is.
So you have a 0%, technically no increase in the tax rate, but you're spending still slightly increased.
Correct, in the event of providing services for which user fees are collected,
and
for example.
Second question, which is probably another one of the most asked questions, but again, think of this as a grade 7 class, is if there is a decision made to also shift the tax burden somewhat, how much we don't know, from business to residential, that zero also could be affected as well by that, correct? In other words, you could end up with a zero scenario, but a residential tax increase of, 4% or 3%, whatever it is,
sure,
of zero plus because of the shift, if you could explain that.
Absolutely. There are more than one conversations going on at the same time. The overall size of the tax-supported budget, that's one that we just discussed today. At the most recent PFC and coming up here on November 18th, they're also discussing what the relative proportionate share between non-residential and residential taxpayers is. And so in the event that that proportionate share changes, that is another driving force for how the amounts that will show up on property tax bills.
Can you give your name and title, please, for you?
My name is Carla Mail. I'm the Chief Financial Officer.
Mr. Duckworth, can you tell us about the positions that were identified, the different scenarios? Would those be positions that could be collapsed, or would there be layoffs?
So under both scenarios, there's proposed reductions, and they would be a combination of new growth positions that were approved last year that we won't fill, including a combination of vacant positions that we won't fill, including as well as layoffs. So there'll be a combination of scenarios.
Okay, but you can't give us a ratio in terms of what percentage might be laid off.
So unfortunately, I can't do that today until council actually deliberates what services they'd like to see reduced, and so that could fluctuate. So I can't give you the exacts today.
And given the other changes that the city has experienced in recent years in terms of the cost savings exercises, the downsizing, how much more capacity is there to be able to eliminate positions without resorting to layoffs, but still maintain the measure of services? As in, the city's not saying, we're giving up this, we don't do this anymore. How much more can you take out of the organization?
So I can tell you, we've been on this journey since 2015. We found over $600 million in efficiencies and reductions that we've already put in place. We've already put in place $40 million of savings. Again, this year we've committed to council for over the next 4 years and $100 million. We're continually trying to find those opportunities, but they are getting less and less. We've asked our staff within the management exempt ranks for some ideas right now, and we have a list of ideas that we're going to continue to explore over the next few months. But these opportunities are, there's no question, they're getting less and less and smaller and smaller.
One of the things Carla mentioned is user fees as a source of revenue for the city. Just looking at recreation alone, I was wondering if anyone can answer this. This is, it looks like you're eliminating a lot of annual recreation passes in favor of a monthly charge. When you add it up for 12 months, it looks like you're increasing fees significantly for some recreation categories, including seniors. Can you speak a little bit to that?
Sure, I'm happy to speak to that in a preliminary way at least. My name is Katie Black and I'm the Acting General Manager for Community Services. So what I can describe is that one of the recommendations that came out of the zero-based review of recreation opportunities or rec services was that we move to a fee schedule or a fee structure that was more in line with industry standards. And so what that means is that although there will be some circumstances where costs will go up, there are more circumstances where costs will go down. So there are some pluses and minuses in the rebalancing of this, but it's all intended to create a more streamlined process for the user. And so the idea is that people will be able to sign up for a continuous monthly pass program without contracts or sign-up fees, but it's the idea of a monthly pass that we'll be moving to.
That's more convenient? So you'd have to go back every month to the city?
No, just the opposite. The idea is that once you've signed up, sorry, I probably wasn't clear about this, there would be a monthly automatic renewal process that could be stopped at any time, but no contract involved, but industry standard is that you sign up and then it's renewed automatically until you opt out or opt not to.
Just one follow-up. Are we projecting increased revenues from recreation fees or...
I think the intention of this adjustment is a revenue neutral adjustment.
I think it's on wages. Next week on the table, there'll be a notice of motion about perhaps some unionized employees foregoing the 1.5% pay increase for 2020. And of course, council hasn't made that decision. That debate will be on Monday. What would be the financial benefit of that? What would the city be able to get if those employees said, we'll forego the 1.5 for 2020 as part of this project process? How much money would you get from it?
So I guess the first thing I would say is we don't have contracts with all employees. So there, police in particular, we do not have a contract with. Just this morning, our management exempt employees were informed of a pay for performance decision of 0% for 2020 that has already been incorporated into the budget information that you have seen. And for the balance of those union members that we have come to a collective agreement with, it's about $14.5 million that their 1.5% comprises. That's an approximation.
Okay, and then quickly, if I could ask a question of Mayor Nanshi.
Yes.
Nobody's asked you this, I don't think. Which is.
Nobody ever asked me anything.
How do you feel, I mean, an easy question, how do you feel about, on first glance, how do you feel about these scenarios? Where are you comfortable with? What do you think the city can be comfortable with in your own opinion as one vote on council?
Yeah, so I don't want to play all my cards now. I don't want to play all my cards now because I think I want to hear what the public has to say and I want to hear what my colleagues on council has to have to say. I will say that So I don't want to play all my cards now because today is just the public release and I received these scenarios at the same moment that the public received them. And so I will say that I am actually pretty impressed how much administration was able to find that doesn't have huge impact on frontline services. I think that'll make the decision a fair bit easier moving forward. But I am really interested in what the public has to say. I'm really interested in what my council colleagues have to say. I'm really interested in making sure that, as always, when we're looking at this budget, we're taking a broad, long-term view. Because ultimately, you can think about it in two ways. We're going to have a giant fight over a week on $5 a month to the average house. In reality, I suspect our giant fight will be on $2.50 a month. I think the first $2.50 is probably pretty easy to deal with. And while this stuff feels so important in the moment, we also have to recognize that when you make it more difficult for people to get to work by transit on the weekend, or when you close down recreation facilities that are catering to low-income seniors to do their aquasize, these have huge impacts on people. And so I would urge my colleagues on council to really be thoughtful about saving 25 cents versus having real big impact in people's lives. And I think that that is the conversation that we really have to have.
So you don't sound, sir, like a fan of zero, given the potential impacts on services.
Well, here, look, the challenge with zero, the biggest challenge with zero, is that it means a pretty big cut to the police service. There's no other way to do it. You can't rely on the other services to keep covering for the largest service. And so council really has to say, are they more wedded to the zero, or are they more wedded to protecting the police service?
What do you say to those councillors who have come out after your session and said they want, and I think they said it in the meeting too, that they want lower than zero? They want.
Well, you know, bluntly, they should have asked for it a long time ago. We've had this conversation never ending for the last year. And fundamentally, I will not support anybody saying to administration, go find more money. These folks have done it. If you have ideas of things you want to do, bring them forward and we'll debate them. But don't just say, hey, administration, do my work for me and go find more money. You had your chance, and that's been done.
Can you speak a little bit to this difficulty where...
Hey, this is not my press conference. Okay go ahead.
Where we've got on the table 0% tax increase, 1.5% tax increase, 3% tax increase, but we're probably not talking about any of those figures even for the very average house, are we?
We are for the average house, but of course there's no such thing as average.
Thinking about obviously the provincial tax requisition and the tax...
Okay, so clearly the provincial tax requisition, not my issue. I'm just the tax collector. They send us a bill and we charge people and we send them the money. So that's on them. Everything we're talking about, the zero, the 1.5 and the 3.02 are on the municipal portion of your property taxes. That's what we control. Even within that, by the way, administration has found $13 million in the 1.5 scenario to cover off the cut that the provincial government made to the police. So even then we're covering for them. But ultimately they choose their tax rate. They charge those taxes, we just collect it for them. The province of Alberta does not try to find savings if the federal government increases their taxes to keep everyone whole. That's just not how that works. So that's number one. Now the second issue is the tax shift. The Priorities and Finance Committee meeting had a, Priorities and Finance Committee had a very extensive discussion on this. I don't agree with the characterization that it was not a good discussion. I thought it was a great discussion on whether it makes more sense to make the decision on the tax shift before we see the budget or after we decide on the budget. Obviously, I believe we should do it after we decide on the budget. And then at that point, council will say, all right, you know what? We think in order to help small business in our community, in order to make a difference for business, we might move $10 or $20 or $100 a year from business to the average residential homeowner. But I really believe the council should make that decision once they've decided on what service levels are appropriate for everyone.
But we're still talking about, even if council, several council members have indicated they want that 0%, it won't be a 0% likely.
Well, it all depends on the decision. It all depends on the decision they make on the shift.
What will you be looking for at the shift?
I think that we are a little bit out of sync here. I think we should move more to a 50-50, maybe more than that, scenario as we go forward. But ultimately, as I've said many, many times, the percentage isn't what matters. Nobody opens their tax bill and says, wow, I'm paying 3.12 times what someone else is paying, or I'm paying 49 or 51 or 52%. What matters is the actual amount of the bill. And so there are many cities in Canada that have a much more favorable business ratio, but also have much higher taxes for both residential and non-residential. And I'm interested in keeping taxes low and then figuring out what the burden should look like.
But you think there should be some shift, perhaps?
Well, I think that the last few years, through no fault of our own, I think Councillor Gondek's point is a good one. It's been an outcome. We've never made an actual decision on it, but because the assessment of the non-residential went down so much, we got a bit out of sync. You know, it's always been, when you look at the property tax alone in the 50-50 range, and we got a little bit out. But there is a chart, I wonder if you have it, Carla, I thought it was very interesting, that actually shows that percentage over time, over many years. And it used to be two-thirds. In the time you've been covering City Hall, it was two-thirds business, one-third residential. And we've been moving closer and closer to 50-50 in kind of an inexorable trend over many, many years. And I think that that makes sense for that trend to continue.
During these tough budget deliberations, what's your message to the Chamber of Commerce on Wednesday?
Well, come to the speech. It's tomorrow morning.
Preview. Entre trois scénarios, il y en a un que vous favorisez. C'est quoi votre message aux Calgariens alors que les consultations vont arriver?
Donc, je viens de regarder tous les scénarios aujourd'hui, juste comme tous les citoyens. Donc, je n'ai pas fait des décisions sur quel scénario que je favorise. Et maintenant, c'est important d'entendre les citoyens et d'entendre mon collègue au conseil municipal et aussi mes collègues ici, de parler de quoi on peut faire et on va faire toutes les décisions au fin de mois. Okay.
How do you plan to build on Build Calgary's economic competitiveness with a lot of deep cuts and just...
Oh, that's the most important question we have to face, and we have to get ourselves out of short-termism. Because the point that I've made many, many times is if we increase taxes by 3.02%, we'll have the lowest residential taxes in the country. If we increase them by 1.5, we'll have the lowest residential taxes in the country. If we increase them by 0, we'll still have the lowest residential taxes in the country. So we have to make sure that we are not being penny wise and pound foolish. We have to make sure that we're not making cuts that hurt our competitiveness, our ability to attract business, our ability to fill the downtown. This is really, really critical. And so throughout the budget debate, you're going to hear me say a lot, all right, is that cut going to hurt us in the long run? Does that save people 5 cents a month today, but actually prevent our ability to fill 300,000 square feet downtown? And these are the things that we're going to have to be laser focused on. You know, a great example of this, and one that we've discussed a lot, is those two pools in Inglewood and the Beltline. If our overall goals are to bring vitality into the inner city, to bring more families into the inner city, to make better use of infrastructure, which ultimately saves us a whack of money by not building much more expensive rec centers in brand new neighborhoods, then does closing those two make it more difficult to attract people to the inner city? These are the conversations that we have to continue to have.
What about tech industry? What you do in the province to kind of encourage that?
I've been doing a lot of that. You know, I believe that, you know, it's not really relevant to our budget, but I believe that even in the provincial budget, you've got to continue to invest in things that will have dividends in the future. And when I do my economic development work, it's very, very, very rare that I have people who are talking about moving their head office to Calgary and paying corporate taxes in Alberta. The vast majority of the work is people who are saying, we want to expand in Alberta. But generally, they pay their corporate taxes where they're domiciled. So the argument that says, you know, if we reduce corporate taxes for everyone in Alberta, that will encourage expansion of non-Alberta businesses, I don't understand the logic behind that. And so when you look at the various investor tax credits, the film tax credit, and so on, those were very specifically designed and focused to bring expansion of those kinds of industries into Alberta. And without those, we have one fewer tool. We still got lots of tools, great quality of life, good overall business environment. Calgary, as you know, is the lowest cost of doing business, according to the C.D. Howe Institute, of any major urban area in North America. So we still have lots of tools. But losing those tools just makes the job harder. All right, thanks everybody. I'm gonna shut up because it's their press conference.
Can someone explain the impacts of affordable housing at that point?
Yes, you're right. This is in my area. And you are also right that Silvera, along with all of the civic partners, has been asked to take a share as part of getting to the 0% tax increase. The other changes that we are proposing to make to get to that 0% tax increase include both capitalizing some staff work so that it means there's less money that's available for building the housing eventually, but it means that we have the staff to keep the program going and keep the developments going. The other change that will happen is a reduction to the funds that we have available for public engagement, awareness and advocacy. So when we are going to build affordable housing in new communities, one of the things that's important is that we engage the residents of that community, and we're going to have some less capacity to do that as a result of these changes.
There was also a line about libraries having fewer locations. Does that mean branches could be closed?
I'm afraid I don't have the details of what the Calgary Public Library has in mind, so that's a question that you would want to direct straight to them.
Are you the right person to fire as well? There was a reference to under both the 1.5 and the 0% reduction scenarios or increases, you know what I mean? That there'd be a fire emergency station referred.
Yes.
Can you tell us where that would be?
Yep. It would be in the North Central Corridor. It was put in place. It was originally scheduled to be built in 2020, and what was identified was the community of Livingston. But as I have already described, the build-out is just happening more slowly. So we're just going to be ready to respond when we have appropriate capacity in that area.
Could you tell me, it says emergency station. Is that a fire hall?
It's a fire hall.
Thank you.
Sorry, Katie, was that full size or is that one of the temporaries that goes into typically new communities? Do you know?
I'm trying to recall whether it looks like it would probably start as a temporary facility. That's generally the way we are going with these things these days.
Okay, yeah. So a deferral of a temporary.
That's right.
Well, thanks everybody. Thanks for coming. Thank you very much. Thank you.